numbers are normal.
We're crowded. We're certainly glad that everyone's out this morning. This morning, we're going to spend some time talking about Lot. You see, many things in life are not as they seem. And then I think this fact is actually well illustrated by Lot in the fact that he chose the well-watered plains of the Jordan from our scripture reading in Genesis chapter 13, verses 5 through 11. Now, the green pastures, I believe, deceived Lot into thinking that he would be better off over there. However, what seemed to be a good choice to Lot at the time was actually probably the worst one that he could have ever made in his entire life, and perhaps was. You see, we're going to talk about this greener side that we all have this tendency to want to go to. Abraham and Lot came to an area between Bethel and Ai, according to verse 3 of chapter 13 of Genesis. To the northwest was the mountainous area of central Canaan. To the southeast was the Jordan River Valley and the Dead Sea. Abraham asked Lot to decide which direction he would choose to inhabit, and Abraham would go in that opposite direction. Now, Lot made a decision based entirely upon the appearance of the land. He looked out, and he said, that looks good, that's nice and green, we'll go there. What Lot failed to do in his decision was to consider other things. You see, what Lot failed to consider was how the inhabitants of the Jordan Valley, same might affect his family. And you think, well, that's not the primary concern. His herds are the primary concern, and his herds need grass, and green grass is preferred over no grass. But in the area which Lot chose, it was a city called Sodom. And if you would, let's go back to Genesis chapter 13. And let's just continue beyond the reading to verse 13 itself. Genesis chapter 13, verse 13. But the men of Sodom were exceedingly wicked and sinful against the Lord. Now, do you think by chance Lot knew that? You see, big cities oftentimes have reputations for being evil. I mean, if you talk to me about going to Las Vegas, or maybe New York City, or Chicago, L.A., I mean, I can just go on and on. We're talking about Kansas City this morning. It seems like the bigger the city, the worse they are, but nonetheless, they have a reputation for the evil in which is conducted there. And maybe Lot should have given some thought to that particular aspect of this decision. You see, the inhabitants, according to that verse, were exceedingly wicked. They weren't just wicked. They were exceedingly wicked. They apparently did it very well. So much so that eventually we go over to Isaiah chapter 3. Isaiah says that they didn't even try to hide their sin. Let's go to Isaiah because I think this is an interesting commentary on this particular situation. Isaiah chapter 3 and verse 9. Isaiah chapter 3 and verse 9 says that the look on their countenance witnesses against them, and they declare their sin as Sodom. They do not hide it. Woe to their souls, for they have brought evil upon themselves. And so he's comparing Sodom to the situation at hand, and he says, they declare their sins as Sodom. They do not hide it. Apparently, Sodom had the reputation of not only being evil, but they didn't care how evil they were. In fact, they declared it. If you told them that they were evil, they'd agree with you and probably do more or do worse. That's the kind of city Sodom was. In fact, let's go to Ezekiel, because Ezekiel describes Sodom's wickedness in chapter 16. Again, another interesting commentary, Ezekiel chapter 16, just two verses, 49. And 50. Look, this was the iniquity of your sister Sodom. She and her daughter had pride, fullness of food, and abundance of idleness. Neither did she strengthen the hand of the poor and needy. And they were haughty and committed abomination before me. Therefore I took them away as I saw fit. Talking about Sodom and Gomorrah, talking about their sister city. They were idle. things were brought for them or were done for them. They had everything in abundance. And so you would think that they would perhaps use that abundance to take care of the poor. No, they were haughty. They didn't use their money for good, rather, or their provisions for food, or for good, but they rather use it in a bad way. In fact, they use that idleness to commit more wickedness. They really needed to spend more time in the field, I guess, but they didn't have enough time in the field because everything was so well watered and preserved. You see, Sodom and its sister city, Gomorrah, were so wicked that perverted men wanted to rape two strangers whom Lot tried to protect. Now, unfortunately for the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, the two strangers were happened to be angels. And in short, God destroyed those cities and everyone who lived in them. And that's according to Genesis chapter 19. You can read the whole chapter. The only survivors were Lot and his two daughters. Now, before we beat up on Lot for making this extremely poor decision, or perhaps, as many commentators do, the Haptic conclusion that Lot was a selfish man, and he just wanted the best things in life for himself. Before we go there, I think we should ask ourselves, which direction would we have chosen? If you were Lot, or in Lot's shoes, or if you had something similar to what Lot is being asked to do, or asked to decide, where would you choose to go? If you were with Abraham and you're overlooking these plains, and what would you decide? You'd see these wall green pastures on one side and the valley, and you'd see these rugged mountains and perhaps not too much grass up there, and you've got herds, so where would you decide to go? Something I think that we perhaps ought to make mention of too, going back to Genesis chapter 13. And verse 10, it says the plains of Jordan were comparable to the Garden of Eden. Chapter 13, verse 10, and Lot lifted his eyes and saw all the plain of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, as you go toward Zoar. He says, like the garden of the Lord. He's talking about the Garden of Eden. He's saying the land in that river valley was so lush, was so beautiful, was so green. It was like the Garden of Eden. So I ask you, if you had the choice, would you rather live where you live, or would you like to live in the Garden of Eden? Would you rather live in the Garden of Eden, or live in Rep City, or wherever you happen to live? Where would you like to live? And honestly, I think 99% of us probably would have said, Garden of Eden, Rapid City. Now, I don't have nothing against Rapid City. Don't get me wrong, but Rapid City is very nice. But I think a lot of us would be tempted, like Lot, to say, hey, I wouldn't mind living in Garden of Eden. Everything's nice there. You see, I think what I'm trying to express is that we all suffer from the grass is greener on the other side syndrome, we call it that. We might long for companionship when we meet a particularly attractive person of the opposite sex. And it appears that we found the person of our dreams. And if that's the only consideration, the appearance of the situation is all that I'm going to take into account, then maybe we can play this person for me, right? Should I marry that person? If we're offered a job with great pay and benefits that promises to make us independently wealthy, doesn't it appear that I found the ideal job? Have I? You know, that cigarette commercial sure did make smoking look appealing, right? It appears that the guys are attracted to women that smoke. So maybe I should take up smoking? Or the members of the congregation, you know, they get upset after hearing a stern lesson. So apparently, preacher, you need to get rid of the preacher, right? Or Johnny's parents, they punish him. It appears that Johnny's parents don't love him. Is that what we're supposed to assume? Or did you see that cute guy driving that sports car? Well, it appears that he's wealthy. But is he? You see, we often make assumptions that really shouldn't be made. And I think Lot really did much the same thing. It appears that that grass is greener on the other side, and that should be where I go. Strictly based upon the appearance. Well, what does the Lord tell us to do? Well, let's go over to John chapter 7 and verse 24. John chapter 7 and verse 24, Jesus simply says, do not judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment. Now Jesus, I think we all give him credit for being the wisest person in the world, of all known time. He says, don't make your judgments based upon appearances. Don't judge according to what it looks like. I think he's implying that maybe we should make some investigation. We ought to maybe research a little bit. We ought to maybe get all the facts. We ought to judge righteously. We ought to make a good decision rather than a hasty decision based upon appearance. We all like and all are partial to nice, good, aesthetically appealing things. We all are that way. Yet if we make our decisions based on appearances, folks, we will almost always make the wrong decision. That's one of the takeaways I think we need to take from our lesson this morning. If we're going to make a decision based upon appearance, watch out. James chapter 2. Let's read verses 2 through 10. For if there should come into your assembly a man with gold rings and fine apparel, and there should also come in a poor man in filthy clothes, and you pay attention to the one wearing the fine clothes and say to him, if you sit here in a good place, and say to the poor man, you stand there, or sit here at my footstool, have you not shown partiality among yourselves and become judges of evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brethren, has God not chosen the poor of the world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Do not the rich oppress you and drag you into the courts? Do they not blaspheme that noble name by which you are called? If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you do well. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the laws of transgressors. For whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in one point, he is guilty of all. Ouch. The Lord is telling us that you really shouldn't be judging according to appearances. Whether it's an individual comes in off the street to services, if he's wearing rags, I shouldn't assume that he's not worthy, that he doesn't belong here, that he shouldn't be listening. No, it's the exact. And then I'm actually sinning and I'm making a tremendous error in decision based merely upon my impression or the appearance of things at hand. Let me ask, would you rather meet a poor person or a rich person? In a way, Jesus is asking that question, isn't he? Is a rich person or a poor person more likely to sue you? It's kind of his argument, isn't it? He says, you know, when you really think about it, we like the aesthetically appearing individual who's rich, but he's more likely to bring you to court than the poor guy is. In fact, a poor guy, Jesus' point, is he's more likely closer to God due to his humble status. Would you rather meet a pretty woman or a nice woman? Is the nice woman or the pretty woman more likely to snub you? This doesn't matter how it is. Likewise, a nice woman is more likely closer to God, again, by her humble attitude. But what did the Lord tell us? James chapter 2, verse 9. He says, but to show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. We should not show partiality. Showing partiality, he says, is simple. When I was in high school, the children would always vote for the most popular candidate for class president. That made me irritated. Because the guy who was probably the best qualified individual was the ugly nerd. And he knew what needed to happen, and that he could certainly make the vote. But no, everybody had to vote for whoever's most popular. And we see the same kind of thing happening with presidents even. When Obama was running, people were voting for him just because he would be the first black president. What kind of logic is that? You see, based upon appearances, that's all they really cared about. Even religions today are not as they seem. Let's go over to Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2, let's read verses 18 through 23. Let no one cheat you of your reward, taking delight in false humility and worship of angels, and treating on those things which he has not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind, and not holding fast to the head, from whom all the body nourished and knit together by joints and ligaments grows with the increase that is from God. Therefore, if you died with Christ from the basic principles of the world, why, as though living in the world, do you subject yourselves to regulations? Do not touch, do not taste, do not handle, which all concern things which perish with the using, according to the commandments and doctrines of men. These things indeed have an appearance of wisdom and self-imposed religion, false humility, and neglect of the body, but are of no value against the indulgences of the flesh. False religion, as the Lord points out, has an appearance of wisdom. And a lot of people get sucked into it. They decide where they're going to go to church based upon the appearance of what a particular denomination or religion offers. After all, you know, they do good work, they present inspiring lessons, they teach and practice love, they draw large crowds to the concerts, but they don't hold fast to the head of the church, do they? You know, if all I made a decision upon where to go to church was based upon appearances, it probably wouldn't be a small congregation such as ours. Not that being small is any problem, because it is. Look over to Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 through 23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. What does that mean? Continue. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and then did many wonders in your name? I.e., these are religious individuals. People who are proclaiming a worship of God. Verse 23, and then I'll declare to you, I never knew you, depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. You mean there's religious people out there who are lawless? Yes, that's what Jesus is saying. There are religious people out there who aren't even abiding by what God says. In fact, he says up front that not everybody who says, Lord, Lord, will go to heaven. Only those who do his will go to heaven. In other words, what he's saying is there's religious people out there who aren't doing his will. And we've got that rampantly in our society. So if I was going to make a decision, I certainly hope concerning religion or what church I might attend, I certainly hope it would not be based upon appearances. Because appearances can fool you. Next thing you know, you're going to be going to the church of Sodom. You know how that worked out for Lot. People would rather get the religious instruction from a well-groomed, priestly-looking, smooth-talking pastor than they would from an old, gray-haired, ugly bus driver who happens to know and practice the truth. And isn't that sad? As though we got to make decisions based upon appearances again? As though that's how we make decisions? And what I'm warning us against is doing just that. Don't look towards appearances. Don't look towards the greener side. Make a righteous decision. For 2 Corinthians chapter 11, let's start at verse 13. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also transform themselves into ministers of righteousness. will be according to their works. There are a lot of false teachers out there who look godly, who look by appearances to know what they're talking about. But if I don't do my homework and I get sucked in and I go to those places, guess what's going to happen to me? Just exactly what he says. The ends of those, well, they're going to get what they deserve, is what he's saying. They're going to lose their soul. Do I want to lose my soul as well? Because I made a rash decision based upon the appearance of the situation. Lot was a righteous man who tortured his soul every day because he made a decision based upon the appearance of the land. And I don't know how I can stress that thought to you anymore. Going over to 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 6 through 8. Listen to what he says. And turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them to destruction, making them an example to those who afterwards would live ungodly, and delivered righteous Lot. Now, I know here's righteous Lot. He was a righteous individual who was oppressed by the filthy conduct of the wicked. For that righteous man, dwelling among them, tortured his righteous soul from day to day by seeing and hearing their lawless deeds. Think about that. Lot was a righteous individual. He made a bad decision, and because of that bad decision, he lived every day until the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, tormenting his soul, watching and seeing all the wickedness that was around him. So wicked, he was even trying to prevent two strangers from being raped by his neighbors. All because the grass was greener on the other side. Do you think by chance Lot regretted that decision somewhere along the way? I certainly believe he did. And I believe that if he could have done it over, or could do a do-over, he'd certainly say, Abraham, why don't we both just share the mountain over here somewhere, because going down there is going to be bad news for all of us, whichever one of us get down there. I can't help but think maybe Abraham, in his wisdom, knew that this was going to be a tremendous decision. He, too, probably liked that green-looking pasture, but didn't want to make that call. They didn't want to be the person to make that call. So he turned it over to Lot. Because he probably knew, as we all talk about, things aren't as they say. Many times the best route is the worst route. It looks good. It looks appealing. It has our interests. We want to go there. We want to do that. But that's probably the last thing we should possibly do. If our decisions are based upon appearances, we're going to be like Lot. So before any of us makes another decision, let's take the time to be sure we judge the matter righteously. That's how the Lord tells us to do it. Not upon appearances, but do it righteously. Things are not always as they seem. Looks are deceiving. If it's too good to be true, probably is. All these things, honey. Don't judge a book by its cover. Green, the grass is greener on the other side. I'd also like to make one last observation. But the grass is also greener over the septic tank. So if by chance you need our prayer, we'd be glad to pray along with you. Why don't you come as we stand and sing.